Live, Laugh, Larceny discusses true petty crimes that may be disturbing to some.
Or could be easy listening to all you psychopaths out there.
All stories are based on actual events. But details may vary.
Listener discretion is not advised.
Live.
Laugh.
Larceny. Welcome to Live, Laugh, Larceny, when criminals have a case of the Mondays. This is Trevin.
And I'm Amanda. Damn those Mondays.
You know, I've realized that me doing the memes on the Mondays for our social media, I'm leading the charge on the war on Mondays.
I can see your followers beginning to grow in that department. Everyone's like, take down capitalism and the Mondays.
Yeah, I still do my horror stuff, but it always ends up being Monday related just because I'm usually just in such a sour ass mood because it's Monday and I'm at work and throwing it together.
I get it, though. On top of that, Trevin,
yes.
Do you have an additional dreadful dilemma for us today?
I have one. It has to do with the Chiefs game, the Chiefs championship game. We record these ahead of time, so by the time this comes out, the Super Bowl will have already been over.
Oh, so maybe we won and maybe we didn't.
Maybe. I'm just happy that we made it.
Yeah.
My family has this thing when we watch football games that either I show up a little bit late or everybody just decides, hey, we'll watch the noon game at like 1 because my dad loves using his DVR.
Oh, fancy time.
Yeah.
Yes.
So We'll fast forward through most of the commercials. So there are actually a lot of commercials in the world that I just haven't seen because, and even though I'm a football fan, I just miss them because we fast forward them.
Do you do that even during the Super Bowl?
No.
Okay.
So in the playoffs, I try to be like, okay, dad, we need to start the game on time because I want to be up to date with everybody because there's always that off chance somebody sends you a text or you're always just like, I can't check Google right now because what if?
Right.
And a lot of times, because my mom's going to hear this and she's going to be like, but. A lot of times it is because I show up late. So it is a lot of my fault.
Mm-hmm.
But when it's the playoffs, I'm like, okay, family, if I'm going to watch the playoffs with you, we have to watch it on time.
Yeah.
It's a lot more important than just a regular game.
And also, I don't know about your neighborhood, but
fireworks.
Yeah, there's always fireworks. And there's sometimes they will shoot off a firework after every touchdown.
Oh,
so, yeah, I was going to say that would ruin it if you were behind. You'd be like, well, here we go.
The year the Chiefs won the Super Bowl, we were a tad behind.
Ooh.
We were like, oh my gosh, are we going to come back? And then we heard fireworks. I'm like, I'm going to guess that we did. Anyway, so my mom was out of town and she was showing up later. So we said, hey, to help you out, we're going to order pizza and we're going to bring it. And she's always cooking good stuff for us. So we'll pay it forward. So I ordered Domino's from right over here by my house. I was actually showing up a little late. I was like 10 minutes late to Domino's. And everybody behind the counter was like super baked. They were looking at me like I was an alien or something. Like they're just like, what? And I said, yeah, I made an order here. I'm like, what's your name? Trevin. Trevin.
Were they teenagers?
Some of them were. There was two women at the side and they were literally were sitting there flipping dough and looking at each other going, I think you should get a DNA test. Yeah, I think you probably should. That was the conversation they were having with each other.
God.
And the dude just looked at me like I was so dumb. And I think it's an easy button that they push all the time because there's another Domino's just up the same road. And they're like, I think you sent it to the wrong location. And I said, I know I did not send it to the right location because this one is so convenient to my house that I didn't.
Oh, my God.
So they went back and forth and they were like, oh, well, give me an order number. I gave them the order number and the girl said, oh, we have to have this. And the manager runs around asking everybody and everybody just looks at her like she's an alien.
Like got three heads on her?
Yeah. And so she said, I'm sorry, we're going to have to remake it. And I just wanted to be like, don't say remake it because I know you didn't make it the first time.
Or their high asses ate it.
Or, I mean, plus it was right before a football game, so you know they were busy.
Yeah.
Domino's has the little tracker thing and it said that Marjorie made it.
Marjorie.
So they looked at me like, if you want to wait a minute, we can make it. And I was like, no, I don't want you making it. So I ordered the same order to a different Domino's the next town down because I was like, I'll just stop there on my way to my parents. And so I did that, and that one was super far behind. It actually took them like 55 minutes to make the pizza. So I made it to that location in like 12.
Oh my God.
And me, Emily, and Mabel sat in the car watching them work.
Oh my God.
For like 30 minutes.
Trenton.
And then we showed up very late to the game, and I didn't get back home until after 11. So I was tired on Monday, but...
So is Domino's your go-to pizza place?
Sometimes. I mean, as far as big chains go, I think so.
Oh, okay. We never get Domino's. Not saying that it's bad. I just don't know. I never get Domino's ever.
If it's Emily and I, we don't do pizza places. We do Mod or the places where you can make the personal ones for yourself.
Yeah.
And we'll usually get like a cool personalized salad too. We don't usually order pizza unless it's a party or something.
Yeah.
Just because we don't like to have that much leftovers.
Oh, I see. In my household, there can never be enough pizza for Jordan or my daughter. They are both gigantic. And I like pizza too, but they are gigantic pizza lovers.
Nobody loves pizza like Jordan loves
Nobody.
Pizza.
Nobody. Wow. Well, that's dreadful. That's a very long time. And that is very unprofessional, Margie. Calling you out right here and now, girl. I also have a dreadful dilemma. There is no one that I can blame for Uh-oh. This problem but myself.
It's you. Hi.
I'm the problem. It's me. Yeah. If I was going to try to blame it on someone else, maybe Lila could take a tiny bit of the blame and maybe inflation as well.
Oh, I'm on your side now.
But realistically, it was probably me. So... I don't know how much I've talked about this on the show. I think I may have hinted at it, but you know this about me. Like, I'm a very frugal person. I was raised by a mother who is an accountant. She's very good at budgeting. She was always, you know, teaching us the value of a dollar growing up.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm kind of not one of those people that even really wants to buy things for myself even at all. But when it comes to my kids, you know, that's the one area where I don't mind spending a little money on them and things like that. So, long story short, I took the girls to Carter's, which is a kids' clothing store. So we went in there and I thought we were doing a hell of a job. I really did.
Mm-hmm.
And my daughter's getting older. She's going to be turning 5 this summer. And so I'm kind of letting her take the reins on her style and her fashion a little bit more.
Uh-oh.
And, you know, we had Winnie in her little stroller. And so we're just filling up the bottom of the stroller. Oh, you like that? You like that? Cool, cool, cool. You know, and I'm like, oh, this is cute. Now, I'm thinking everything's going to be fine.
Uh-huh.
Because I am shopping on the clearance racks and I'm trying to like, you know, no, baby, just get one of that. No, we don't need that. Like I was telling her no.
Mm-hmm.
So we get to the cash register and the lovely, lovely gal begins to ring us up. And when I see the total, Trevin, immediate embarrassment just came over me. This has never happened to me ever in my life because mm-hmm. I'm usually very proactive about keeping things in order and in line and not going overboard. I look at the price and it's over $500 fucking dollars.
Whoa. I was thinking you were going to say like $230.
No. Obviously, I don't have that money. And even if I was so rich, okay, I would never go on a $500 shopping spree for my kids who are going to grow out of this stuff.
Right.
So I immediately am just so embarrassed. And I just tell the lady, I'm like, holy crap. I was like, I'm so sorry. We just went so overboard and I had to put so much stuff back. I was like, I'm sorry. I have to go through this right now. And I'm taking stuff out of the bag. I'm like, that's the no pile. This is the yes pile. No, 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 no. And I cut it down to like a small fraction, very small fraction. I don't even think it was over 200 by the time I was done.
That's good.
And it was for both kids, and we were buying a birthday present for someone else, too. Anyway, but My dreadful dilemma is I had to just make a total ass out of myself and put a bunch of shit back. I've never had to do that before, ever in my life.
Yeah, I hate those really cringy, embarrassing moments that just don't seem to end. Like, it's one thing if, like, you say something wrong and somebody says, oh, you're dumb, and you feel bad about it and you just dwell.
Yeah.
But you literally, it's like falling down a really long hole and you're just like, you're still watching me and
no,
I suck.
No, it took forever. It took forever. And the only thing that made it less embarrassing is that there wasn't a line behind me or something.
Oh, that's good.
It wasn't even busy. We got in right when the store opened, and I think there was only like one other person in there shopping. If I would have had a line of people behind me, I think I would have cried.
Yeah.
I really think I would have just straight up had a meltdown in a child's clothing store.
I don't think you're alone. I think there's a lot of people that would be crying with you on that.
My God. And you know what, though, is so silly. So I'm not a person that really gets embarrassed that easily. I feel like I can make an ass out of myself and move on with life. I dance like an idiot on the dance floor. I don't care. I'm just that kind of person. But this really embarrassed me.
Well, I think the surprise of it all has a big part of it.
Yeah. And the really wild thing is that the embarrassment almost made me consider, do I just pay for this and then be fucking broke?
Yeah.
And I was like, oh my God, if I was like a little bit more weak-minded,
yep.
I wonder what other people would have done in that situation.
I bet some people would have done it.
Their pride would have gotten in the way or something. I don't know. But for me, that was just an absolute no. Like, I would go through 500 million times the embarrassment to not pay a bill that high. But I was just curious. I was like, what would other people do? Would they just be like, well, I'm an idiot.
And Emily is just so used to doing this. But I think Emily would have paid for it.
No way.
I bet she would have cried. And then she would have returned it the next day.
You think?
She's really big at returning things.
Okay.
She gets something and then she says, I probably shouldn't have done that. And then she takes another trip and goes, returns it.
Yeah, buyer's remorse is such a real, real thing.
Mm-hmm. When that happens to me, it's usually just because I bought one thing that I thought was cheaper than it was. And I'm just like, oh no, put that one thing back. But you had to go through a mountain of things.
It was a mountain, a straight up mountain. So are we going to do a round of top five or what?
Let's do some top five.
One, two, three, four, five.
Top five.
So, Trevin, what do you think about spicing things up a little bit?
Well, sometimes I'd like to be spicy. Spoken like a true spice lord.
Seriously, that needs to be a famous quote. So I have today for you the top five hottest peppers of all time.
Oh, sweet.
So I actually found a very, 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 very helpful article. Well, not even an article. It's a website. And like, they are so on top of their game.
Mm-hmm.
They keep track and they're constantly updating. Like, whoa, this pepper just, I don't know, got discovered.
This thing just climbed the charts.
Yeah, yeah. Like, they're keeping an up-to-date record.
All right.
And the website is called pepperhead.com. And I found it under pepperhead.com/top 10 world's hottest peppers. Now, before I get into this, they describe how they come up with the hottest peppers, and they use something that they abbreviate as the SHU, the Scoville Heat Unit. Have you heard of this before?
I've heard of Scovilles, yeah.
Okay, so it's a measure of spiciness, which I found that to be very interesting. I did not know that at all.
Like, is there a scientific... There's got to be, but...
It says SHU is a way of quantifying how spicy a pepper is by measuring the concentration of capsaicinoids.
Capsaicinoids. I'll take it.
Who knows? Capsaicin is the chemical responsible for the spicy sensation within a pepper.
Hmm.
So any guesses before I get into this?
That's cool they can measure that.
I know.
What, ghost pepper? Oh, I don't know enough pepper names. It's definitely not jalapeno.
I will stop you because I don't think you're going to get the rest of these. I will say, according to this website, the ghost pepper talks a big game, but it isn't on the top five.
Isn't that what those little, you've seen those chips, the piquitos or something like
that? Damn it, I should have brought it.
Those are ghost peppers, aren't they?
I don't know, but I thought you were going to say there is this chip that you can buy one single chip. Is that what you're talking about?
The blue skull on it.
Yeah, Jordan has one in our cabinet. I should have brought it and forced you to eat it on air. I'm just kidding. I would never do that to you. But maybe I should record Jordan eating it and put it on our social media or something. No, ghost pepper is not on here. Let me actually see. Ghost pepper is actually number 7 on the list.
Okay.
So it's on the list, but not the top 5. So let's get this thing started. Number 5 is the Trinidad Scorpion, in parentheses, Butch T. Don't know what that means exactly.
Is that T-E-A?
Just the letter T.
Okay.
It is a previous Guinness World Record holder from Australia. And, you know, it kind of just looks like a habanero to me.
Oh, it's cute.
Yeah, cute little red guy. Okay, so that's coming in at number 5. Number 4 is the 7-Pot Primo, which I have never in my life heard of this. But the 7-Pot Primo is another red pepper. The first one is also red and small. Mm-hmm. But this one has a very distinct look to it. It has a tiny little tail.
Oh, a little pokey.
Yeah. Oh, my God. It actually says some pepper cultivators have tried to replicate the look of this by breeding their own peppers to have a long stinger.
Wow. Pepper breeding.
Oh, my God. I didn't know that that was a thing. Are you ready for number 3?
Please, I love the names of these.
Number 3, and this is another one with the number 7 in it. So number 4 was 7-Pot Primo. Number 3 is 7-Pot Dougla. I wonder why.
Does that have anything to do with the Scoville number?
Maybe. I don't know. But will you check out this effing pepper? It's kind of brown and it looks old.
Looks like it's rotted.
It looks rotted. Yeah. So the 7-Pot Dougla is the hottest pepper you can find that isn't red. I found that to be a little fascinating. And apparently it has really, really good flavor. I'm never going to know that for
I can't
fact.
Imagine you'd have much of a flavor if it burns your tongue off.
I know. But yeah, it is one of the hottest peppers that is not red.
Weird.
Looks really wrinkled up and really, really weird.
I would call that like the zombie pepper because it looks like it's decaying.
Dead. Yeah. Straight up.
And then it'll also give it that cool mystique where it's just like, will it make me dead?
I know.
I gotta try it.
Oh my God. You really need to be on the marketing team for these pepper heads.
Well, whoever is breeding these peppers obviously aren't writers. That's all I'm saying. 7-Pot Dougla.
Yeah. Come on. We can do better. We can do better.
Stick to watching peppers hump and quit trying to name them.
So number 2 is the Trinidad Moruga Scorpion.
Moruga.
Now, look at this guy. It is another small red one. Has a little bit of dimples in it, I'd say. Little dimples here and there. Now, the description of this one really cracks me up on this website because it says, straight from the depths of hell, the Trinidad Scorpion Moruga blend is a rare sought-after pepper that was only just recently discovered.
That's so crazy that you're just now discovering things like that.
I know. Apparently, it's native to the lands in Trinidad and Tobago. And apparently the heat just never stops building once you bite in.
So there's people that ate it like 2 months ago and they're still just...
The heat is escalating as we speak.
They're just holding on for dear life.
It never leaves you. Now, are we ready for number 1?
I need number 1 right now.
Number 1 is the Carolina Reaper.
Damn it. I have heard of that. Yes. Okay.
Now look at this bad bitch.
Oh, she got a little bit of a curly stinger.
Yeah, there's a stinger on this one. It's also a small red one. But what's interesting is the bottom of it kind of divots in and then the tail just comes out.
Yeah, it's like the more deformed and mangled it looks, the worse it is for you, I guess.
I guess. This is really, really interesting. The previous world champion was the Carolina Reaper, and it beat itself recently again, and they found another Carolina Reaper that has a higher SHU number. Again, it's just remaining on top. I don't know why they spelled it out like that, but it was ranked as the world's hottest pepper in 2013, mm-hmm. and then it was tested again in 2018, and that's when it came back with an even higher number.
Wow. Watch the throne.
Carolina Reaper is 200 times hotter than a jalapeno.
I can't even imagine what that is.
Like, I can't either, because I can't do jalapenos. I mean, I talked about this way back, but I'm mm-hmm. kind of a little bit, I think, allergic to jalapenos.
Oh, that's right. It makes your throat.
I get these weird little like ulcers in my throat when I eat jalapenos. It's so sad. So obviously there's no way in hell I'd ever eat any of these. Would you?
I don't know. My friend Tyler and I used to go to Buffalo Wild Wings, and we would always be like, come on, we got to get the hottest one. We just have to do it. And I know that's probably nothing compared to these.
Yeah.
But by the time you take a bite into it, your head gets sweaty.
Yeah.
Your taste buds are in self-preservation mode and just like, quit working. Don't die.
Yeah.
So then the rest of your meal's ruined. And we used to be like, we at least have to get one each. And then we just stopped doing it because it ruined all of our meal after that.
Yeah. Like, what are you guys trying to prove?
So, I mean, if I was just like not about to eat dinner or something, I guess maybe if it was just like, hey, it's 1 p.m. You had lunch a little bit ago. Take a little bite.
Do I want to torture myself real quick?
Yeah, I'm all fine with torturing. Just don't ruin a meal.
Midday torture? Yeah. Oh, my God. So that's the world's hottest peppers. And definitely check out this website. I actually enjoyed it a lot. Mm-hmm. There's pictures. There's facts. It sounds like every few years they're discovering new peppers. They're breeding them. They're re-ranking them. It's a whole world I never knew.
Yeah, somebody probably is in an office right now stressing about what number to give a certain pepper. And that's weird to me.
That's wild.
Well, I probably won't be having one of those, especially since some seem hard to find.
Yeah.
So I'm going to give you the top five strangest animal births.
Wow.
Because I know you like animals and...
And birth.
Birth.
Two of my favorite things.
If there's two things I know about you.
Animals and birth. Sign me up.
So let's just jump on in to some nasty old births.
Okay.
Number five is the male seahorses, because the male seahorses give birth. Did you know that?
No.
Oh, I thought everybody knew that.
No. Is that the only creature that's a male that gives birth?
Maybe.
Maybe. I don't know. I didn't even know that one existed. Okay, go on.
To reproduce, the female seahorse leaves her eggs in the male seahorse's brood pouch where the eggs are fertilized. Sometimes the eggs are attached to the male's tail instead. I don't know how that works. After about 20 days, the male gives birth to more than 1,000 tiny seahorses.
Whoa.
I guess it says the pipefish and the leafy sea dragons also give birth this way. So I assume that means male.
Okay. Learn something new.
Number four, the chichlid, which is a type of fish.
Okay.
Chichlid are from the large fish family called Chichlidae, which includes tilapia and angelfish. When they reproduce, the male puts the fertilized eggs in his mouth, which is where they stay until hatching. This process is called mouth brooding. The male fish is unable to eat at this time. Sometimes the female fish will carry the fertilized eggs in her mouth, or the male and female will trade off, which is called biparental mouth brooding. Typically, fish that are born via mouth brooding are underweight at first and require recovery time to feed and grow.
What, they need to go to the fish ICU?
They just need to take her easy for a bit.
Oh my God, or I guess the fish NICU. Oh my God, what? I couldn't imagine being like, all right, babe. Well, you can't even talk. They're in your mouth. What are And they're like, okay. And then you just pass the fertilized egg back and forth.
Yeah, swapping spit you thought was bad. How about swapping your eggs?
Oh, my God.
Also, I'm coming from businessinsider.com. I have no idea why they did this. But
that's really random.
Yeah, that's very odd. I meant to say that in the beginning. Anyway, number three is the cuckoo catfish. It's funny because this is actually going to tie in a little bit with the chichlids.
Okay.
So the cuckoo catfish engages in a chaotic game of cannibalism to give birth. The catfish use the mouth of the chichlid to harbor her eggs. The cuckoo catfish will actually swim over to lay an egg in the mouth of the chichlid for her to carry. so they really don't even know they're doing it. While this is happening, the male chitlid dives in to fertilize what he thinks is the female's eggs, but are actually the cuckoo fish's eggs. And all of this happens in a few seconds. Because of the catfish, eggs grow and hatch faster. The newborns come out and then usually eat the chitlid eggs before they're born.
I'm sorry, what?
So it's like uterus hijacking, but it's their mouth.
That is not right.
No, it's very rude. And could you imagine you just had your babies robbed, you know?
Like, excuse you? Fertilize your own shit. Mm-hmm. Like, I can't. This is my mouth, baby.
Yeah, I didn't talk for 2 weeks for this.
Oh my God.
Number two, the Australian spider wasps. To reproduce, the spider wasp first injures a huntsman spider to the point of paralysis. Then the wasp lays its eggs in the huntsman spider's stomach. The wasp waits for the egg to gestate and hatch. Then as the egg hatches, the wasp devours the rest of the spider.
Okay, that one's even worse. Because at least these little fishies get to live after that.
I mean, the baby eggs of those don't.
Right, right. That's true.
And you probably never look at your mouth the same again.
I wouldn't.
And number one, flatworms.
Ooh.
Flatworms lay fertilized eggs that grow in a cocoon inside their bodies. The worm can fertilize its own eggs with sperm from its body. Flatworms can also reproduce by splitting off a piece of its own body and then allowing it to grow into a second worm. A third option for flatworm reproduction is called penis fencing, which involves pushing their sperm into the exterior skin of another flatworm.
Okay, you're telling me.
There's a lot of options.
They have three different options that we know of that they can reproduce.
Mm-hmm.
Can you imagine being a flatworm in sex ed class?
I'd be like, I am not going to pass this test.
I'd be like, wait, teacher, I have all the questions.
Yeah.
Just one of those is weird and fascinating all on its own. But to have three?
Yeah.
I don't even know about that. I don't know. These flatworms kind of weird me out now.
Yeah, they're just weird little blobs too.
Interesting. Well, thank you. Wow. Yeah. I learned a lot about animal births.
Yeah, your favorite thing.
Well, you know what wouldn't be as weird as talking about that?
Perhaps ads?
Some ads! So here we go!
Whoop!
So, we have now reached story time. And it is my time to go first. I have a story from the news, and this isn't just a news story that I looked at myself. This is actually a story that was emailed in to us as a suggestion from a listener.
I love that. If you have a story that you think maybe it would be better if you heard these fools tell it, Send it.
livelaughlarceny@gmail.com. I know we always say that at the ending, but in case you don't stick around, there it is again. This was sent in by a person named Ala, and they said that they are an avid listener of our show. They heard about this story from actually a comedy show, and they didn't tell me what the name of that was, but they said, you know what? I need to hear this on your show.
Yes.
So thank you so much for sending this in, and let's just jump right in. Here we go. There are two types of people in the world. Those that prank and those that get pranked. Unfortunately for Trevin and I, we are both the latter, while our significant others are the pranksters. I have had fake spiders placed on my toilet paper roll. My full drink guzzled down as I turned my back for a sec. And have been scared shitless by my husband Jordan popping out of our pots and pans cabinet.
You asshole.
Don't believe the full terror I've endured? Well, head back over to episode 1 for a full-ass petty crime story about it. As for Trevin, his latest prank encounter I was told about was Emily filling his water flosser with vodka.
Floss on that, bitch.
Thank goodness Trevin gets fresh water before each use, or he would have ended up with worse breath than he started with. I'm sure we've all experienced a prank that went too far. An act that went from ornery to awful. Today's story details the events caused by a petty prankster and the aftermath that followed. Joshua Douglas James was destined to become a pranker even before he was born. Joshua's dad originally asked his mom out on their first date as a prank.
Yeah, we should go out sometime.
It wasn't until halfway through the date when his dad realized his mom actually had a winning personality.
I like to go to the park and throw rocks at children.
Months later, Joshua's mom planned on pranking his dad back with a fake pregnancy announcement. But the prank quickly reversed back onto her when she peed on a test stick and it read, positive.
Oh, shit.
Even as a small fetus, Joshua was pranking. Doctors assumed he was a girl throughout the entire pregnancy. But as it turns out, Joshua was hiding his tiny weenie from the sonogram text the whole time.
Like father, like son.
After Joshua was born, his pranks only escalated. At school, he would make fart sounds every time his teachers would bend over. At home, he would replace his dad's Rogaine with his mom's Nair. And at church, he would make the wildest confessionals to freak out the priest.
I put laxatives in the communion wine.
Joshua was on a dark and prank-filled path. It was a lonely way of life. Friends and loved ones continued to distance themselves from him, claiming that he tricked them so often, no one could tell if his love was even real.
I don't know what to believe anymore.
Joshua had even recently lost his girlfriend, Wendy, after pretending to propose too many times, followed up with tying his shoes.
Psych, how do you keep falling for this?
So on a sad October evening in 2015, 23-year-old Joshua drove around Loxahatchee, Florida, all alone. Still heartbroken over his breakup with Wendy, he knew of only one thing that would lift his spirits. A prank. But to who? And what? That is when Joshua screeched his truck to a halt in the middle of the desolate road he was on. On the side of the road was a 3.5-foot alligator, and he immediately knew his next prank. He grabbed the gator, threw it in his truck, and headed towards his ex-girlfriend Wendy's favorite restaurant. Wendy's. Joshua knew a couple of the workers at the Wendy's drive-thru and figured he would pay them a visit. Plus, he was a little thirsty after chasing down an alligator. When Joshua arrived, he placed his order for a large Coke.
We'll have your order at the window.
And pulled forward to the drive-thru window. With the gator riding shotgun, Joshua grabbed his Coke from the worker and waited for her to turn away. That is when he grabbed onto the gator's tail and flung it inside the open window. Joshua quickly drove off, hearing only distant screams of fear as the worker jumped out of the drive-thru window. He couldn't help but laugh as he fled the scene. It wasn't until 4 months later, Joshua was tracked down using surveillance video and a purchase from a nearby convenience store. Joshua's mom was quoted in saying, "It's just a stupid prank that's turning into all this. He does stuff like this because he thinks it's funny." He was charged with assault with a deadly weapon without intent to kill, illegally possessing an alligator, and petty theft. Just a few more months later, Joshua was found guilty and sentenced to 12 months probation and 75 hours of community service. Along with paying a fine of $1,200, the judge ordered no contact with any Wendy's restaurants and no possession of any animals aside from his family dog. Things were much better for the alligator used as Joshua's prank war weapon. It was ultimately captured with no injuries and released back out into the wild. Pranking may seem like a great idea to some of you. It might be the way you show love and affection to others, or just a fun pastime when you are bored. But to those pranksters out there listening, I urge you to consider the possible negative outcomes of your ornery actions. Because pranks can escalate to the point of no return. My advice? Stay away from crocs and don't be a crook.
Pranksters beware, because I've got my eye on all of you.
Did you enjoy that I included you in the beginning of that?
Oh, God. You know, the thing that I think makes it the worst, although I don't like to be pranked.
Right.
Because I don't like surprises.
Uh-huh.
But Emily's got a thing where it's almost anti-humor, where it's like not good pranks generally. So she'll do dumb things and say, oh, I pranked you. I'm like, that wasn't even a prank. And she's like, ha 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 ha. And it's just too much for me sometimes.
Yeah.
You really trigger in my PTSD there. But
so sorry. Hey, you know what? I'm triggered too, because Jordan is kind of the opposite of Emily, where his pranks go so far to the point where they're not funny, not because they're just boring or pointless, because they are terrifying to me.
Yeah, I think Jordan's actually good at pranking.
Oh, God. He's too good at it.
So, okay, I was aware of this crime and I never covered it. Well, obviously, but I never never read into it.
Okay.
So the mom really did say it was a prank. So that's what gave you the jumping off point, correct?
Yes.
I didn't even know that.
Yes. The only things that are made up in this story, obviously, I do not know Joshua's backstory. That was clearly the fib of this, was him being a prankster since before conception.
Mm-hmm.
And also I made up his girlfriend, Wendy. But every single detail about the crime is true. The Wendy's thing, the charges, the way he did it. He actually knew someone at the drive-thru window and thought it was funny.
Okay.
There are actual interviews that I watched of his mom, and she is just beside herself in these videos. Just totally floored that things have even escalated to this point. She's like, he's a prankster. This is just what he does. Like, he wasn't trying to harm anyone. And for those of us who don't live in a state where alligators are just everywhere, it sounds a little alarming, but it sounds like to a lot of the locals there, they're like, it was a 3.5-foot alligator, whatever. Like, if it bit you, yeah, it would hurt, but it's not going to kill you or anything. And I'm like, what?
Listen, if you threw a 1-foot snake through a drive-thru in a building I was in, I'd be jumping out that drive-thru window.
Yeah.
And I'm used to gardener snakes and stuff around here.
Yeah.
But I don't know. I'm not a Florida man. You know, maybe it is just a 3-foot gator, whatever. That's fun.
I know. I think they just can be a different breed out there, mm-hmm. as we have all known in the true crime world. But shout out to all of our Florida listeners. Love ya.
Yeah, I'm sure we come off as the most unaware human beings when it comes to talking about Florida people, because they're like, no, seriously, this is not a big deal.
I know.
Like, I listen to your show sitting next to a gator every day.
Yeah, they're like, I have 5 gators cuddling on my lap as we listen. So yeah, the mom is just very adamant that it was all a prank and that he's just a pranker and that's just what he does. And she's just honestly seemed very appalled that he was even being charged with this.
Well, I can see where you came up with the fake backstory about her being a prankster as well then, if she was so unfazed.
So unfazed. So shocked.
So the petty theft is the coke, right?
That's what I'm wondering. And okay. I actually did a lot of research on it because I watched the surveillance video.
Mm-hmm.
And for me, in all of my fast food experiences, you pay for the thing and then they give it to you.
Right.
So in the video, it didn't show any transaction happening, but the girl did hand him his drink, and then when she turned her back is when he threw it in. But in every article I was seeing petty theft.
Maybe that's the person he knew, so they're just like, oh yeah, I'll get you. Like, maybe they just thought it was okay.
I don't know,
because I was also thinking, you said it took such a long time for them to track him down, mm-hmm. and I thought, wouldn't his card information be on file there? So he must not have paid for the drink.
That's true, because in every article that I read too, they obviously had him on footage, but you can't see him in the one where he threw the gator. But they said that they tracked him from payment from a local convenience store.
Mm-hmm.
And their surveillance, so I don't know, but it took him 4 months to find this guy. And it also makes me wonder if he knew the people in the drive-thru. I don't know if he actually knew the girl that he threw the gator at, or if he just knew other workers working in the back. Mm-hmm. That wasn't clarified either. But wouldn't they have turned him in?
Yeah, you'd think at least one person would be like, okay, that's like, it's not my friend, but I know he's my coworker's friend and I hate him. Mm-hmm. And he scared me.
Yeah. But the gal that's in the video that he threw the gator at, she did testify during the court and everything. And she was even like, I was so scared. I jumped out of the drive-thru window to get away from this thing. So I guess we're not super crazy for being freaked out, because she was too.
Yeah.
But according to his mom and other local news animal experts that wrote in, everyone was acting so chill about it. So I don't know.
I guess it's easier when you're not the person in the situation.
Exactly.
It's like, oh, I would have totally kicked their ass. And it's like, okay, let's put you in that situation and see what you do.
That's so true.
Yeah.
So I don't know about the petty theft thing. That's the only thing I can think of, is that she must have either given it to him before asking him to pay, which I've never experienced in my life, or maybe she gave it to him for free and they wanted to just slap that charge on him too.
Yeah.
I couldn't find anything about that. And I read a lot of articles, so I don't know. But yeah, petty theft was also on there.
That's crazy, too, that he was also told to stay away from Wendy's particularly.
Uh-huh.
Particularly. So he can't have a Baconator. He'll have to send somebody else or DoorDash.
Or a Frosty.
And he can't have animals.
That was the thing that shocked me the most. Because we've heard stories where people are like, okay, you're banned from going to this restaurant, or you're banned from whatever. Which, honestly, there's no way you can track that.
That's too big of a chain.
But to top it off, saying you cannot have an animal in your presence other than your family's dog?
Also, how do they track that? If you went to your local shelter, are they going to have your picture up behind the counter?
No! No, they are not. I'm going to stand firm in that. I don't know why that was even a thing. I get it. That was not cool of him to just throw this little gator in there.
Oh, yeah, not cool.
None of it was cool, but I don't know. I just think the punishment was really interesting.
Yeah, maybe it's a bad opinion to have, but just because you threw a gator doesn't make me think that you're cruel to animals.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. We're both huge animal lovers.
Yeah.
I'm with you, though. I mean, agree.
If you drop kicked a gator, then I would
that
say
that would be
yes.
different. That would be different. And also the fact that the gator, I'm really glad that they told me that the gator was okay. Mm-hmm. It made that very clear, like no harm was done to this gator. We had the proper steps taken. It was captured with no injuries and let back out. So I don't know if the gator would have been hurt. I could see them being a little harder on the guy, but I don't know. The whole thing is just so weird.
Yeah, that's the kind of the fun thing about our show. And we're telling these stories that are very ridiculous, very out there. And so the way that they choose to punish the people and fix the problem are sometimes very unheard of, just because the situation's so unheard of that they don't know what to do.
I know. And a lot of times, we say this a lot, we don't even know what they're charged with or how they're punished.
True.
This just happened to be one of those that, as I was scanning all the different articles, I noticed that there were some updates. So it's like, this happened on this month. And then it was like 4 months later, there was an update. And then there was like 3 more months later, then he was sentenced. And so I had all the steps of it, really.
That's one of those ones, too, where I'm just surprised it got drug out as long as it did.
I know. It was like a big news story, apparently. Mm-hmm. But thank you again for sending that in to us. Like we've said before, yes, do we love getting our listeners' personal petty crime stories? Absolutely. But we've been getting a lot more recommendations for news stories as well.
Oh, yeah. We just love hearing from you guys.
We love hearing from you. And I know, like I said, we've been getting a lot more emails recently. So if we don't get back to all of you, just know we still love you. We can't get to everybody's story. But just keep sending them. Keep sending them as things come up.
Yeah. And as a writer, I'm a total diva. And so my stories sometimes have to reflect something I'm going through or something I'm really feeling.
Right.
So it's a little harder for me to jump on the listener stories. I think I kind of make Amanda do the heavy lifting with those.
That's okay.
But I will still do some here and there.
Oh,
but yeah,
yeah.
I just got to be feeling it. Got to be feeling the creative juices.
I don't think any of us can fault you for that. I mean, we're writing a petty crime story on a weekly basis.
Yeah.
And it has to hit your inspiration, or it's just not going to be fun for us or for anyone listening.
Yeah. It's all about being real with you guys.
Yeah. So, Trevin, is it your turn?
It's my turn, and it's going to get wild in here. This one's going to be a little different, not in the way I tell it, but just it's a very different kind of story for me.
Okay, good. We've been having some of those.
But don't worry, it's dramatic.
That's all we can ask for.
I don't think I have anything to say. This will be one of those where we'll have a lot to say after it. So here we go. There is nothing quite as jarring as a surprise. Whether good or bad, these unexpected events are there to wake you from the complacent state you're in and give you a shock. No matter the intent, there is no shortage to the types of surprises that we as people can experience. From the soul-crushing defeat one feels after receiving a positive pregnancy test, to the excitement a soon-to-be grandparent gets once you share the same news with them.
Hoo-hoo! Now you can see how much kids fucking suck.
The abrupt revelation can make that moment in time memorable. Think about it. The memory of things going exactly to plan rarely sticks with us. It's when your emotions or expectations are shifted that you are mentally awake and fully taking in the experience.
Wow, I'm really taking this in.
Oftentimes, these situations cause us to think fast and make decisions that we normally wouldn't make because we simply don't know how to handle it. Life happens outside of our comfort zone. Now, let's take everything we know about surprises and put them towards our food. Surprises with food can also swing from good to bad experiences, but more times than not, we find them to be bad. Ask anyone who has worked at a customer service job in the food industry. People do not like food surprises. There are a certain kind of people in the world that will get a tiny piece of power and let it go completely to their head. And let's be honest, most of these people hold no real power, so they take full advantage.
Excuse me.
These are the kind of people who are quick to ask to speak to a manager when the cheese from their burger slightly touches one of their french fries. For these individuals, if they feel a situation is for them, they will get upset with anything that isn't 100% what they want. No reasonable human error or staffing situation is a good excuse. They paid for an experience, and for that small amount of time that they paid for, they will not settle for anything short of exactly what they want.
I'm a very important person.
This is exactly why most instances of surprises with food have a bad association. If you haven't been out to eat with one of these culinary complainers, you've certainly seen the aftermath of one while you were out.
I said no fucking pickles!
But before I get into this story, I want to make sure you know that they are not all bad. Not too long ago, I went to Andy's and got me a James Brownie Jackhammer frozen custard. I dug my spoon in and filled my mouth with tasty flavors of vanilla custard, brownie, peanut butter, and hot fudge. But as I got a little further down into the cup, I took a bite and was surprised by what was in my mouth. There, in my Arctic cold mouth, laid a foreign object. That object? An Oreo.
Oh!
Now, I could have been a total Karen about this and threw a fit, but I decided to ride the wave of this mistake and see just how far it could take me. And let me tell you, that Oreo sent me sailing all the way to the white sandy beaches of Flavor Island. My body tingled, and my mouth sparked at this tasty surprise. For me, a meal is like a great jazz performance. The trumpets are blaring, and bass is moving me. Sometimes there are mistakes.
Shit.
But that's just jazz, baby. The improvisational skills are what separate one restaurant experience from another. Those surprises are the spice of life. And sometimes those spices are the surprises.
What the fuck? Is this mint?
But I know most people don't see things the same way as I do. And as much as I wanted to sway your mind to see how food surprises can be good, I have to face the facts that not all food surprises are as fun as an Oreo in your ice cream or an engagement ring in your favorite cupcake. Sometimes a surprise with your food can lead to crippling fear and a call to your local police department. Lamia was a mom living in Akron, Ohio. Living the life of a mother was no easy task, but she managed to find time for her own hobbies. Even though she felt it was her motherly duties, she took great pride in her ability to cook amazing meals for her husband and kids. She was the family chef, and everyone respected her as such. Along with being an amateur cooking enthusiast, Lamia loved to jump on Facebook Live and broadcast all of the happenings in her life as a mom.
Hey, y'all.
From popping on to share her new favorite brand of toothpaste, to streaming her children getting ready for their first day of school.
Get out of my room!
There was nothing she wouldn't send out to all of her followers. Some would say she shares a bit too much information, but it gave Lamia a sense of community. If she set up her camera just to tell the world that her favorite color is no longer pink, and she's leaning a little more towards red now, one thumbs up from a viewer was all she needed to make it all worthwhile. On a beautiful day in the late summer, Lamia returned home from the Save-A-Lot grocery store with all of the fixins to prepare her signature dish, turkey tails and beans. This dish was beloved by everyone in the Singfield family, and Lamia's was out of this world. Although this meal was a bit more time-consuming than others, it was completely worth it. Seeing her children slowly chew the fatty meat chunks while smiling brought a sense of pride and honor to her job as the mother and head chef. Lamia added the spices, beans, and turkey tails to the pot, bringing it to a nice low boil. The smell of bay leaves and meat filled the home, causing family members to frequently peek in and see what's cooking.
Something smells mighty good.
She would always be quick to shoo them away.
Get the hell out!
After all, Lamia was the artist, and no one gets to see this work of art until it's finished. After some time had passed, Lamia returned to her pot to check on its progress. They're gonna gobble these turkey tails up, she said to herself. But as she began to stir the hot pot of beans, something caught her eye. As she stirred the beans around to uncover the pieces of turkey tail, a different sort of meat made its way to the surface. It was girthy, moist, and phallic.
A penis!
Tamia shrieked. Hearing the yells of his wife, Tamia's husband, Ron, came running in. Together, the two inspected the alleged dong. They followed the shaft up and marveled at its bulbous head.
Wow, even I'm impressed, Ron said. Listen, honey, if it makes you feel better, I'll eat the dick. I don't want you to raise a stink over this.
Feeling like her husband didn't do much to comfort her, she reached for her phone.
Don't,
Ron exclaimed.
Do not go live on Facebook over this. Not everything is an excuse to go live.
But just as Ron had left the room and was far enough away, Lamia picked up her phone and logged into Facebook.
Hey, y'all,
Lamia said to her phone.
I've got to be quiet. My husband said not to go live, but I've got to share this with you.
Lamia went on explaining that this particular piece of meat looks very familiar to her, without explicitly saying just what familiar object this meat resembles. She went on joking about the meat and how it could possibly be meat that belongs to a pig. However, as she whipped the dong-shaped snack out of her pot to show her viewers, that's when she started to have a change of heart. Her tone of playfulness began to change to a feeling of fear.
I know what this is, she said to her crowd.
She then went into detail on how there was a hole at the tip that when she puts a fork into it, it goes all the way down.
I hope it's no human, because then somebody is missing something that they need, or somebody might be dead. I just want answers, she said before ending her Facebook Live.
Lamia then got onto her phone and called the local police department to explain that she believes she found human remains in her beans. The dispatch operator explained that they've never handled anything of this nature before and wasn't sure what to do. After a brief time on hold, Lamia was told that they would be sending officers, a coroner, and the medical examiner to her residence.
The excitement was almost too much for Lamia to bear. The only thing she could do to calm herself down was to call her friend and go live on Facebook. For 2 heart-pounding minutes, Facebook viewers watched as Lamia had a casual conversation with someone on her phone, explaining the whole situation.
So anyway, this happened.
The intensity continued to rise as more and more questions continued to pile. Did she in fact have a penis on her plate? Would the dinner still be good? And why would someone go live online just so people can watch them talk on the phone? But just as the audience was on the edge of their seats, Lamia disconnected from her Facebook Live, leaving her loyal watchers in the dark.
What's gonna happen next?
With the online community frozen in fear and grasping for an update, Lamia had answered the knock at her door. In walked a police officer, the coroner, and the medical examiner.
Step right this way, and I'll show you my penis, Lamia said to the officers.
As the 3 newcomers walked into Lamia's delicious-smelling kitchen, they took 1 long look at the meat in question, sitting firmly on the white paper plate.
Holy dick!
The coroner shouted, just before fainting into the arms of the police officer.
My God, the police officer said. We need to get this little guy back to where he belongs.
The medical examiner then pulled out one of his evidence bags and prodded the slippery Willy inside.
We will get this through testing and get results ASAP, he said.
The second the 3 government workers got outside of the door, Lamia pulled up her phone and began to Facebook Live again. Her audience of at least 3 people could finally breathe, knowing that they had an update. She switched her phone to the back camera and recorded the officer, coroner, and medical examiner as they conversed in the driveway. The whole time they talked, the bag of penis meat just sat on the cop car's hood. As the 3 conversed amongst each other on where they would be taking it,
I'm not taking it.
They kept taking turns flipping the bag over and examining it. After the officer looked up to see Lamia recording them,
what a creep,
they all got in their respective vehicles and drove away. In August of 2020, Akron, Ohio woman Lamia Singfield encountered a schlong-shaped hunk of meat in her turkey tails and beans. While still in the process of identifying its origins, she jumped onto Facebook Live to share the discovery until convincing herself that she was in possession of human remains. Sometime after the police, coroner, and medical examiner left with the mystery meat, tests later confirmed that it originated from a pig and was in fact a pork tail. The presence of a solid bone in the middle also gave this away. Save-A-Lot grocery stores released a statement that they take the quality of the food they sell very seriously and that neither the police nor Mrs. Singfield reach out to them. Lamia was later quoted in interviews saying that she's glad she didn't actually cook a human appendage because she used a $50 pot that she recently bought from Bed Bath & Beyond and didn't want to either throw it away or hand it over as evidence. Some news sources did state that Lamia did get an attorney, still unhappy that her receipt said turkey tails with a pork tail in the package, but no further research could pull up any civil suits about the pork getting into the turkey. What a surprise, right? There wasn't even a crime committed. This just ended up being another one of those classic cases of mistaken penis. But that doesn't mean that trouble couldn't be waiting in your pot of beans or tucked away inside of your bun. Statistically speaking, there is a non-zero chance that someone in the history of the world has unsuspectedly eaten a Johnson, thinking it was something else, right? Either way, for those of you listening today, I wish only good food surprises in your future. May your 6-piece nuggets come with a bonus 7th, or your next ice cream order have a bonus topping that you didn't even know would enhance your experience. Let's save the phallic mystery meat for those who bully customer service workers. Because we all know they should eat a dick.
Oh my God. Whoa, I was so scared. I was so scared. I mean, obviously, because it's our show, I knew it wasn't what mm-hmm. she thought. But whoa, she had me very terrified there.
Yeah, I guess it could have still been a live, laugh, larceny story had it been an animal dick and it was a prank, maybe? We'll see if I ever come across one like that.
Whoa.
But I just thought the situation was so damn dramatic, and she just went so overboard with it that I thought, I think this story should be told on our podcast.
Yeah. So, did you watch all these Facebook Live videos?
Yes.
Oh my God. I gotta see this.
Yeah, she just like scoops it out and holds it up on a fork and is just like, oh, this looks familiar. Oh.
And then she totally like changes her perspective and she's like, yep, I need the authorities here immediately.
Yeah, she eventually gets to the part where she kind of looks at the head a little bit more and she like sets it down and goes, oh, I know what this is.
Oh my God.
But she plays it super cool and funny for the longest time. And then her tone still sounded kind of jokey, but she was like, oh, I'm calling the police.
But what if though, you know?
There's one part where she picks it up and puts it down. And then she is talking to the camera and goes like, and licks her fingers for a second and goes, oh, maybe I shouldn't have done that. And I found that part really funny.
No. Lamia. Oh, well, in both of our stories this week, we did talk about itty bitty teeny weenies.
Yeah, teeny weenies. We had surprises, stories about food.
Pregnancy tests.
We reference pregnancy tests.
Oh my God.
It is just a smorgasbord. of delicious connections.
Oh my God. I know you talked about the Super Bowl at the beginning and little smoky teeny weenies are like a really common thing that people eat.
Mm-hmm.
Oh my God. It's just really something today.
Yeah, this was a different one, but it was a fun one.
Oh, man. So she didn't get in any trouble for calling them.
Nope,
right?
She didn't get in any trouble because they fully believed it, too. They were like, oh, yeah. Shit.
Yeah. I thought you were going to say it was pig's appendage. I mean, it was, but
technically,
like,
yeah.
Like a little weenie. But I'm really glad it wasn't.
So while I've got you on the show, I'm going to show you a picture of it because okay. I want your reaction for the show. And then, of course, we'll have the picture on our socials. But here's the picture.
Oh my God. I mean, it is a very phallic looking shape.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, these pictures look even worse to me. Is that the same thing?
I don't think so.
Oh, okay.
You might be looking at a real dick pic.
You're killing me. Oh my God. I don't think I would jump to the conclusion of that being a penis, though.
No, I don't think I would either.
Yeah, it has the basic shape of it, but...
Apparently that was a different story of somebody finding a different type of meat in something.
Okay, because I was like, that one looked a little more convincing. But I mean, hey, you know what? Better safe than sorry, right?
Right.
If you think that you have human remains in your... turkey and beans, I mean, it's better to call. It's better to call and then to wonder, did I just use my brand new $50 pot
yeah.
to cook this?
Dick soup.
Yeah, dick soup is no fun. So I get it. If you're really, really concerned about it, and maybe the Facebook livers were like, whoa, you know, like maybe they were egging her on.
They might have been. It's so goofy just the way that she handled that, because she literally did call somebody and then just activate Facebook Live and just be like, uh-huh, yeah, well, I did do this, uh-huh. And it's like, why did you even go on live? That's kind of rude. That's rude to your live people if they're going to watch you just talk on the phone.
That is bizarre. People are so weird about what they put on Facebook Lives.
Yeah, she really did say in the first part of the video, like, I got to be quiet. My husband said, don't get on Facebook Live. So coming up with her character was pretty easy because she did have multiple Facebook Lives leading up to this. And she did even say, my husband told me don't do it.
Oh my God. That's something. I mean, shout out to her for giving you amazing character development without even meaning to.
Yeah, thanks, Lamia.
But just so you are all aware, the more you are on Facebook Live, the more likely it is that you will be on our show.
That's true. Anytime there's a camera running, something weird might happen.
Whew. Wow. Well, I hate to say that I'm weirdly hungry after this episode, but it is past lunchtime.
My stomach was actually growling while I was recording at certain points. I was like, I hope, one, the mic doesn't pick it up, and I'm waiting for you to call me out.
Well, I'll admit it for us, so we're hungry, so we're going to go. But just remember, no matter the crime, big or small, In the end, we're all doomed.
Doomed to get a mouthful of mystery meat.
Oh my God! I couldn't even say bye after that. Bye.
See ya.
To those of you who were eating while listening to this episode, sorry, but thanks for listening.
And if you have a habit of going on any giant shopping sprees for kids' clothes, why don't you tell us about it on social media? Find us on Facebook, Twitter, TikTok, and Instagram. Live, laugh, larceny.
And if you have ever worked at a fast food restaurant, tell us the weirdest thing that got hurled into your drive-thru window. Send us your petty crime stories to livelaughlarceny@gmail.com.
And don't be like me when I go to review the Domino's next to me. Give 5 stars. Spotify, Apple Podcast, or Good Pods. It's not a U. I keep saying
The op. Wickle, wickle.
The improvisational.